its relation to mobile. Basically, I will be introducing artificial intelligence, machine learning, the basics of it, not very much deep. We are not going very much deep market details of machine learning, but I will give you the basic idea, and then we will move on to how we as a mobile developer, because we all are just mobile developers, how we can integrate machine learning in our apps, Android or iOS, without having to learn too much about ML. So everyone might have heard about ML kit release from Google in this I/O, right? And in the last I/O, they announced to the world that they have just changed their strategy from mobile first to AI first. It was 2 years ago, and since then it is like the whole world is, tech world is going crazy about artificial intelligence. We have heard about too many many frameworks or tools being released from every company, be it Amazon, Google, Facebook, or Microsoft. So we'll be touching those also. Main thing is that as an Android developer, we are, because of our ecosystem, we tend to only know about the things that Google is interested on, or the things that Google releases, right? But there are so many other things also. For example, if there is ML kit from Firebase, from Google, then there is equivalent or equally robust or powerful tools from AWS also, like AWS recognition, if someone has any idea about it. So we will be talking about that also. You can ask me any question. Just one disclaimer, I am not ML expert. I will just give you a little idea, and I am just an Android developer, and I have worked in the context of that only. Okay. So I have already given my introduction. So you can reach me at paramvirsingh88 or paramvir.singh88@gmail.com. So agenda is, as I said, we'll try to understand AI and ML. Different tools and frameworks using, and then we will move on to using ML in mobile apps. Primarily our focus will be ML kit, and again you can ask me any questions. This it will be interactive session. So what is artificial intelligence and what is machine learning? So artificial intelligence is the branch of science which the objective of which is to make machines enable of mimicking human behavior. I mean, there are many definitions of artificial intelligence. Some say that it's all about, the primary goal is all about mimicking the human behavior of human smartness. Yes, it all revolves around that, making computers or machines capable of doing smart things as machines do. It's not only about smartness, it's about creativity, it's about reasoning, it's about intelligence also. So artificial intelligence is a broader term that we use roughly to refer to the human intelligence, about anything, about artistic behavior, about intelligence, anything. And machine learning, sometimes we interchange these two terms, artificial and machine learning, but machine learning is very small part of artificial intelligence. It's not artificial intelligence. Machine learning is that part of artificial intelligence where we give the data to softwares or programmers, and where we make them learn things. And it's machine learning, it's, as the name says, it's all about learning. As I said, artificial intelligence is about a lot of things. It's about learning, intelligence, being creative, being able to reason about things, being able to take decisions, smart decisions. But machine learning is limited to feeding a lot of data to the machines and make it learn about from its experiences. So artificial intelligence would be the ultimate version of Google. This is the Google's ultimate goal. They want the Google search to be very predominant about everything that is happening in this world. So they want Google search engine, the core Google search engine, to be very intelligent. And they, as Larry Page has announced, that they are not near it, but they are going to be that someday, very soon. So as I said, artificial intelligence is a branch of computer science, objective of which is to make machines as work as human, and it also has cognitive ability, the ability to understand things around their ecosystem. And machine learning is just a computer program that is fed a lot of data and learns from experiences. It is a subset of AI. And then this is artificial intelligence. Then the subset of it is machine learning, and there is a small another subset that is deep learning. Deep learning is one single aspect of machine learning, where it's a little hard for me also to explain and understand, but deep learning is where different aspects are defined as abstractions, I mean layers or filters, you know. For example, if we have to, I will give you one example. If a child if a human has to understand what is a dog or what is a cat, or how to differentiate between these two, I will explain this example further. Mm-hmm. We will see some characteristics in a cat or dog, like how are their ears, how is their face. So we will, in our mind, how our mind process these information, there are some different abstractions or layers of filtering out things. As soon as our mind processes things or data, the image data, we filter out some information, and we pass some information, and ultimately in our mind, in a microsecond, we make a decision that it's a cat or a dog. So you might have heard about neural networks also. So neural network is just the artificial neural networks are just the artificial image of artificial abstraction of those neurons in mind, right? So neural networks are very much used in deep learning. So this is the example of deep learning. There are different levels of different filters. You can call them abstraction also. So the data is being processed, and ultimately it is being filtered out. And ultimately, at one point, we make a decision, final decision, whether it is a cat or a dog. So ML. So is it a new technology? People say that it's the latest cool technology, but to clarify one thing, it is not a very new technology. It's there for decades, 3 or 4 decades. But why it is coming into trends for past few years? Because now we are logistically capable of using it in practical sense. We have that hardware. We have those now. The data science is very popular. Because of data science, we have those algorithms, or we have the zettabytes of data to process and make our models. We have TPUs, the hardware, the smart hardware or powerful hardware that can process those bytes of data, and we have those good algorithms that are now capable of doing things for us. So that's why for last 4 or 5 years, now machine learning is actually practically being used in our day-to-day life, and there are a lot of examples you can see in our everyday life. All of Google products have started using ML or machine learning or artificial intelligence. Like in Google, in Gmail, you will see smart replies. In Google Assistant, is a lot of features. Every feature is derived from artificial intelligence. So only past four or five years, this is being practically used. So types of learning. There are three types of learning in ML. the basics are, I mean, these are the three main types. There are different school of thoughts, and this is the one very dominant school of thought where machine learning is categorized into three types of learning. One is supervised, another is unsupervised, and reinforcement. Supervised is, example is, for example, when you when there is a small child and you teach him about some very basic things by examples, by toys or by some pictures, that is supervised learning. You know, when you give, and in terms of machine learning, when you feed the programs a lot of data, and every data is categorized, is named or labeled. You know, you are, for example, how Google Translate works is, or how it has learned is, they have, Google has a lot of language data, and they have fed the Google Translate algorithms with a lot different language data with labeling, that this is a, you know, this is a Korean word, this is a Chinese word, this is an English alphabet, and they have pre-processed the data, they have labeled it, and they have fed it. So this is how that supervised learning goes. The algorithms already know that, you know, these, what kind of data I'm fed, being fed, and they decide, they take decision on the basis of that. So unsupervised learning, where you don't have any labeling, where you don't give any success or failure, you know, categories to the machines, to the algorithms, and they decide, they fed a lot of data, and they create their own pattern. They recognize, the software itself recognize the pattern in the data, because it's not 10,000 items, it's not million items, it's like billions of items, billions of use cases, right? For example, if there is a chess, you have to create a model or a machine learning algorithm for a chess program. You will not, you know, you will not be able to tell a lot of if cases, if or else cases. You will not be able to write a lot of if else cases for a software to learn how to play chess. You will have to feed millions of different use cases, millions of different play rules or already games data that have been already played. You will feed that to that software, and the software or the program will learn about the pattern. It will be able to create patterns about those games, and it will be able to then, when we give a new question to the to that software, on the basis of that pattern, it will be able to deduce what decision it has to take.
Wouldn't chess be more suitable to the reinforcement learning?
Yes, yes. Reinforcement learning, yes. In reinforcement, you tell, you backpropagate the data to it. For example, what is reinforcement learning? It's kind of unsupervised learning, but with addition of feeding back the result. Whether, for example, in the case of chess program, you have trained the model, you give it a new use case, you ask it to solve it for us, and if it solves and we find that it has successfully solved that particular use case, we feed it back to it. Mm-hmm. We say that yes, it is now, you are successful. If unsuccessful, we say that you are unsuccessful. So this is how, I mean, we are adding additional success or failure data to it.
So what would be an example of an unsupervised learning without success or failure?
Unsupervised learning,
basically unsupervised
about
learning,
it's in images or videos, it I mean, the major examples are images or videos. Sorry,
I was saying that basically supervised learning used in deep learning,
uh-huh.
It's not basically used in my machine learning.
Mm-hmm.
Means, of course, deep learning is the subset of machine learning. So if you want to get the example of unsupervised learning, then you will get in a deep learning examples. So like automatic car driving. So these are the unsupervised learning examples. It's learned from their own experience,
mm-hmm.
With the experience of making the decision in the future. These are, I think the supervised here we want to differentiate unsupervised learning from the supervised learning, because in supervised learning the data we are feeding to our machine learning algorithm that has also has output.
Mm-hmm.
Like suppose you have to create a model in which you have to find out the credit card fraud.
Mm-hmm.
So what you do when you create your model, you feed the data which has fraud data also.
Yeah.
So accordingly you train your data.
Mm-hmm.
So this is like supervised learning. Your training data has correct data and the fraud data. Accordingly model train itself so that in future when it will be exposed to new kind of training data, it can easily identify, okay, this is the fraud data.
Okay.
So this is supervised learning. Unsupervised learning, we don't have anything, means we don't have output in our training data. It has to figure out it its own. So in this supervised learning and unsupervised learning differentiate itself. And reinforcement and unsupervised learning is kind of same, learning from own experiences.
I think a lot of image processing algorithms will come into the category of unsupervised
learning.
Yes,
they create
planning.
Patterns and
To find the patterns based on some mathematical models.
Okay.
Yeah.
So basically, but yes, understanding these, I mean, you are halfway done in the basics of ML if you have understood these three terms. So now I am going to define these little harder terms: convolution matrix, deep neural network, tensors. I don't even know the spelling, so we will not talk about that. So because again we are mobile developers and we are not going to start machine learning as a career, so let's remain. We will go for the simpler terms like data, model, training, learning, because these are important for our use case. What is data, what is the model, how training works, how a model learns, what is experience and decision making. Clear? Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So how ML model, so model is a very important term in machine learning. A model is what is created by using that data. I've been already using model in my in my sentences. So model is when you use data, the raw data, when you process it, when you do a lot of processing on the data, and then when you apply a lot of algorithms on it, we create models. Model is a combination of the data, the experience, and the algorithms that work on that experiences. And model is then capable of having, when a model is prepared, it is now capable of solving the fresh use cases. And when we start feeding fresh use cases, it will give us the decisions. And it is, while working, it is learning about new experiences also. So it is iterative approach. Right. So how ML models work, we process, we give the data, we process the data, we train the model, and then we apply the model to the fresh use cases for our applications. How it's all spun together, huge data sets are required. I've already told it's not 1,000 or 10,000 or 1 million items, it's like billions of items or use cases. That is, because if we try to train a model on the basis of only 10,000 or a few thousand of items, the error percentage will be too high, right? In some cases it may work, but in regular use case the error percentage will be too high. So a lot of data is required. We have already talked about how to create and train models. We create data, we create models by applying a lot of algorithms. We are not going into that detail. And also, this is a little flow. We give the data to the machine learning algorithms, and that algorithms find the patterns and try to create a model. And it's not the only single model that is created. It tries to create a lot of models, and as is depicted by this, just try to understand this. It's as I said, it's an iterative approach. We continuously churn the data, we process the data and we apply the algorithms on it, and that algorithm tries to find the patterns and try to create different models, candidate models on the basis of that. So ultimately, when a lot of and we then give a lot of use cases to all those candidate models, and on the basis of success rate, the best model is chosen, and then the best model is then trained further, and it is given the we start giving it the fresh use cases for our use. So what are the applications, how it is being used, machine learning? The simplest use case is image processing. We all know about image, how image processing is being done these days.
You can find all the pictures.
Finding objects.
You can find all the pictures which have dogs.
Yes, yes, yes. These guys, yes. Finding image, that is called image labeling. You can, I will give you the example. Image labeling is where you give the image to an already trained model and it will give you the objects present in that image. So how it is able to detect those images, because how it is able to detect those objects in the images, because it earlier it has been fed a lot of millions of images with labeled data. For example, if I will click the image of this bag, and that model will be able to predict, will be able to deduce that the this object in this image is a bag. That happens because earlier it has been fed a lot of images with the bag label in it. So it is, it was able to define that pattern, and it was able to now match those pattern with this. NLP, natural language processing and speech recognition. Speech recognition, AWS and Google are both doing a lot of good work in that, in natural language processing and image speech recognition. We have already seen the everyday applications like Google Translate and text to speech. Yes, Alexa is the best example, you can say. Predictions. That is again a very important use case, predictions in everything. Like she has given the example, fraud detection, prediction in everything, be it medical prediction, like nowadays on the basis, just on the basis of the picture of these cells, microscopic pictures of the cells, medical science is able to detect whether this particular patient is going to have cancer or not, right? So that kind of prediction or fraud detection prediction or customer prediction, like you have 10,000 customers, which customer is going to buy this particular item, or which customer is going to go away to the competitor, or which customer is going to default on the payments. This kind of predictions, or every prediction about in businesses, data science is all about that. So these kind of predictions, natural events, scientists used to have a lot of challenges predicting any natural event occurring, like any weather event or any natural event. Now on the basis of these data, they are very much closer to predicting a lot of things. And robotics, real-time decisions, yes.
Self-driving cars.
Self-driving, yes. Self-driving cars. There are some specific models or algorithms where these models are able to predict something in real time. Like in the case of self-driving cars, or in the case of a robot running or navigating, data is coming in real time, and it has to detect everything, success or failure, yes or no situation, in real time. So this is happened. This is robots are now capable of this only because of machine learning models. Some recent examples. This is the first artistic painting that has been created by an algorithm itself using only machine learning models. It's not impressive, but it's kind of modern art. But yes, it has been sold of around $1 million, I don't know. But yes, this is the first breakthrough in the case of art, that this is the first painting that is, there was no artist involved. So how it was created, the particular museum or exhibition house, I think the very famous Sotheby or whatever it is, they already have a lot of artistic paintings. They fed that this particular algorithm with all of these paintings, with all of these patterns of different painters, famous painters, and they fed that algorithm with this data, and that algorithm now with the dots created this particular painting. The second example, famous example, is Cambridge Analytica case. Anyone has heard about this? In Facebook case, right? So they have just revealed a few days ago that Cambridge Analytica. So what is Cambridge Analytica case is that everyone might have heard about Trump, that in US presidential elections, Trump side used the Cambridge Analytica was a company which used, which leaked a lot of data, Facebook users' data, and they used that leaked data in the favor of Trump somehow. So one of the aspects was that, although there are so many aspects involved, so one of the aspects they have revealed that they gathered a lot of fashion related data of the users, what fashion things they are buying and what you know they are preferring on the Facebook, and on the basis of that fashion related data, they were able to deduce whether that particular candidate was a liberal or conservative. So can you see the connection? On the basis of only the fashion data, they were able to deduce that. So this is how they, you know, used machine learning 2 years or 3 years ago. Cancer detection, we have already talked about that. Self-driving cars, Google Translate, these are all pretty famous examples. So let's come to the ML frameworks. These are the famous frameworks or tools. You can say Cloud Vision is from Google. Cloud Vision is the parent or the elder sibling of MLKit. You can say MLKit is part of Cloud Vision. Cloud Vision, as Amazon has AWS, Google has Cloud, Google Cloud. In Google Cloud, they have their dedicated APIs, Cloud Vision related APIs, and these Vision APIs are being used by different applications. They are just simple APIs. You can use it. I can show you the example. I think I have a limit on time. So everything in image processing, like extracting the text from the image, detecting what monument is there or what landmark is there in an image, for example, whether it is a Eiffel Tower or it is a Taj Mahal, whatever it is, it can detect, or it can also detect the faces, human faces, and even what are the markings on that human faces, whether it is sad or it is happy or whatever it is. I will not be able to give explicit individual examples on everything, but just try this one. Just.
You'll have to download it, I guess.
Yeah, I just download it. I was trying to save time. So this is just a demo of this, and it is giving, by feeding this image, it is giving a lot of different kind of data to us. Joy, very likely, sorrow, very unlikely, these different gestures of face, plus labels like logo detection or different kind of characteristics found in this image. It's a product, fashion, long hair related, flooring, etc. From where it has found this image, from where it belongs to, this kind of information, the document related data, the whole JSON data that developers can use for their in their applications, and other properties. So cloud vision is, as I said, cloud vision is elder sibling of MLKit. MLKit is capable of all these things. But it is part of Firebase it is specifically focused for Android developers or iOS developers, and it's easy to use that way. Yes.
Yeah. I have a question. Is this Google Vision also give the identity of the person?
So yes, that's a really good question. So there is difference between AWS and Google. In this particular case, this identification of face recognition is very risky in terms of privacy, right? So Google Vision, in case of Deepika Padukone, it will tell that this is Deepika Padukone because it's a public figure. But if you feed it any other person's data and normal person's data, it will not tell that it is a particular. Although Google might know about that, Google knows everything about us, but Google will not tell us that because it's a privacy breach. But Amazon recognition, the framework which is provided by AWS, that will give us that data. But only then if you have a defined set of data. For example, you have a company, you have the data, facial data of 1,000 of your employees, and you feed it that data, and when you have a camera on your entrance, 5 more minutes. When you have a camera on your entrance and you feed everyone's data, face data to AWS recognition, it will be able to detect which employee's face is this. So you got the point, right? It will not tell out of internet, I mean web, whose data it is. But if you have predefined set of
this
your facial data,
this is not possible in Google. Like
this is not, no, right now it's not.
Why
maybe
this
in
policy,
prop-
why this privacy policy is not applied on Amazon and applied on
it's not, it's about product or ethics. Yeah. But yeah, and even AWS, in this case, I don't think AWS is breaching privacy, but yes, they are providing, so far, Cloud Vision is not providing. Yeah.
As an Android developer, would I use MLKit or would I use Cloud Vision?
Cloud Vision, no. We will use MLKit.
Okay.
That is easier to use. And Cloud Vision, I have just given a very simple vision example of Cloud Vision. I mean, there is you might have heard about TensorFlow. Google is working a lot on TensorFlow, and TensorFlow came as a product of Google's efforts in AI and ML, and Google has released TensorFlow to train for the developers or scientists to train and deploy their machine learning algorithms or models. So Google Cloud Vision or Google Cloud offering is a lot bigger than MLKit. MLKit is specifically focused towards.
Let me get back to this. I also think that depends on the use case actually. Because MLKit might not have that comprehensive image processing algorithm.
Yes, yes.
And we might want to use Google Vision API at the back end if the use case is like that.
MLKit is completely on device.
No, no. So I am coming to this point. Yes, that's actually a good point. MLKit, as I said, MLKit is specifically focused on mobile. So they provide all these three offerings. You can create your custom models and you can host it on MLKit server, Firebase server, okay. And you can then deliver it to the to your users. Or you can also use MLKit SDK on the device for on-device ML. For example, you don't want to hit the server every time. So that processing needs to happen. If that processing needs to happen only on device, MLKit SDK is capable of that. But the only downside is that because it's on device, it doesn't have the power of server. Obviously, it will not be that precise. The usual use cases like text detection or text recognition or face detection, that is possible on device only without the help of server. But if you want very precise calculation processing of images, then you have to connect. So there are both aspects available on MLKit, on device as well as server. And even if you are using server APIs, that's very easy. Like I guess everyone knows about Firebase, being an Android developer, and everyone has integrated Firebase. So it's about using simple Firebase APIs. I prepared for the demo, but it's not possible. But everyone can try it out. It's very simple APIs, Firebase APIs, and you will be able to these are the features actually. Image labeling, you can detect every object in the image. You can extract text, it's very easy. You can detect every text, or face detection. It's not face recognition, it is face detection. Face recognition is to recognize someone, and face detection is just to detect faces.
I think then you have to wrap up.
Do AWS also have similar SDK
for
mobile
specific
SDKs, or
they
just
have? Yes, they do have that. Just search for AWS recognition.
Okay.
Yes. So I guess that's it. You can explore from here further. Thank you, everyone.
So I guess we can have 2 minutes for questions if anybody.
Yes.
Has any.
Yes, I'm open for questions. Any kind of questions? Firebase or MLKit or
so this is
AWS?
This is
integration
in Android.
Yes.
Can we have a small demo? It can be covered.
How long will the demo take?
Can you give it
to me? Yes, I had some ready-made demo. Just a minute.
Can you have it in the annual session so the other talks will be over?
Yeah.
It takes a couple of minutes.
Yeah.
I will try to take 2 more minutes, only if it is able to. It's a demo app freely available. It's not mine. It's available on GitHub.
Can you label it up?
I'll check if it is able to.
Is it using MLKit?
It is completely using MLKit only.
On device?
Huh?
It's on device or?
It's on. No, this one is server based.
So Firebase.
I actually prepared for it. Give you a little glance over the how easy using MLKit. So this small code is for detecting the text.
Uh-huh.
You have just three classes. You have to use three classes: Firebase, Vision, Image. You will create the. You will take a simple bitmap.
Uh-huh.
You will create a Firebase Vision Image object of for this, and you will use Firebase Vision, which is a core class of Firebase Vision, and you will create a text recognizer object.
Can you zoom in?
Yeah.
Okay.
Please enter in presentation mode.
View?
View.
Third last.
Third last.
Recognizer object,
mm-hmm.
and you will feed it that image object, Firebase Vision image object that was created earlier, and that Firebase Vision image I created for a bitmap. I just have a bitmap in my resources, and then it is you have to apply a listener, and then it is able to detect that text in this. And every other features flow is also similar. You have Firebase Vision image, and you have text recognizer or barcode recognizer or object recognizer, and you will feed that bitmap image to it. So right now, ML kit is actually not limited to vision only, vision related features. But right now, these are only features that are offered to developers, but it is going to be expanded.
That's it. Thank you.
Yeah. So,